Hello and happy Sunday. I swear, I just blink and it's Sunday again. So glad that folks are able to join. If you're new to Periscope, one of the things that I'll remind you throughout the broadcast is that just by tapping your screen, you can give hearts. So if there's something that we discuss that you feel strongly about or you agree with or you love, you can just tap your screen and give hearts. That's one way you can interact. The other way is you can write comments anytime. You can ask a question. You can share something from your own experience. Sometimes we like to, partway through the scope, check on everyone and see what the temperature is where you're visiting from wherever you are on the globe. So today, we're going to talk a little bit about turning behavior management upside down. So a little backstory on this topic, and then a little bit about where we're going to head today during today's scope. So again, I'm Christy. If we haven't met, I have some new followers today, so welcome. And if you're just watching this broadcast, many of you know me already, but I'm the owner of B2K Solutions, where we aim every day to transform professional development in early childhood. And we're really pushing towards a movement to revolutionize early childhood education in general. So today we're talking about how to turn behavior management upside down. And as I was getting ready for today, my husband said, "So what is it that you're scoping on today?" He didn't call it that. He called it podcasting, because he still gets podcasting and periscoping mixed up. And so I was trying to explain to him that there's these charts and these cards and there's these stop signs and clothespins, and I was trying to explain what these tracking behavioral charts look like in classrooms. And he said, "Oh, people are like publicly shaming kids?" And I was like, "Oh, yes, of course." My husband, the cabinet maker, he gets it, right? He's like, "Yeah, we're not here to publicly shame kids. That doesn't make any sense at all." But, you know, as Ashley and I were really thinking about today's topic, a couple things came to our mind. Definitely what came to our mind is our stand. And our whole team here at B2K, Ashley and myself included, are really serious that this use of these public displays and public tracking systems really needs to stop. It's unethical. It's harmful, but that's also unethical. And it's not even effective. But at the same time, we as teachers know that we get so much criticism. You know, everybody knows how to teach. And, you know, until you've been in a classroom where the kid has bit you or thrown something or is just crying the entire day, you really don't understand what it can feel like in a classroom when kids are in the middle of a meltdown. Maybe you've had one kid with you at Target, or you've witnessed it at an airport, but to really be the only adult that's there to just really take care of all these young children, we don't need more criticism. We really need some solutions. So Ashley and I really wanted to set forth and give some solutions, not just more criticism, because we knew that people often used these public displays with a good intention. And we knew that there were at least two reasons that people gravitated toward them. I mean, this is not a new conversation. We've been having this conversation kind of in a cyclic way with different ages, different grades, different situations, yet we keep coming back to, if you look at Pinterest, there's 100 million variations in every language of these behavior charts and cards. So what is the appeal, and why is it that, you know, despite all the unintended consequences, do we still use them? And so we kind of acknowledged that there is this reality. There is this reality to kids with really significant self-regulation issues, kids with that have been exposed to drugs, alcohol, trauma, stress, and that we really are an N of one, maybe an N of two, but we really have this legitimate struggle when we're trying to teach children to self-regulate. So if you kind of agree that there's this push between, I really want to give kids feedback, But I don't want to publicly shame them, of course. Kind of give some hearts. Just tap your screen and say, yeah, I feel this rub. Or you may be in a district or an agency that is required that you use these public displays of tracking children's behavior. So what is the replacement behavior, right? What is it that we can do instead? So again, Ashley and I said, okay, there's at least two good reasons that are sort of behind the use of these public displays. We kind of know, even my husband knows, that there's this unintended side, right? The shaming, the confusion, the bullying that can happen. But what was it that we wanted in the beginning? So we figured, people like to offer visual supports to kids. It really scaffolds their learning. And why not use visual supports? So we'll come back to that. The second is that people really want to give kids feedback, and they should. Feedback is an incredibly important part of good instruction. So this week and next week, Ashley and I are trying to unpack what does it mean to use visual supports effectively, and what does it mean to give good, effective feedback, but without the public shaming, without the unintended consequences of these visual displays of kids' behaviors. So even if you haven't witnessed this kind of severe word like shaming or unethical or harmful, we're going to argue that it's really ineffective. And this will come up in Tuesday's blog when Ashley and I share a little bit more about what young children's cognitive abilities are in order to understand these very sophisticated charting and graphing systems. So if you're just joining or you're having trouble kind of bopping in and out of the broadcast. Today we're talking about classroom behavior management, home behavior management, target behavior management in a way that doesn't publicly shame kids. And we really want to promote the use of visual supports. So the very first thing, there's going to be four today things we're going to talk about, and then a quick call to action. So the first thing is we need to turn our thoughts about behavior management upside down. And that means we are no longer the manager. We can still be the queen or king of our home or our classroom or our agency or the car where our kids sit, but we're not their managers. And so we got to switch or turn upside down this idea that it's our job to manage their behavior. The second thing we need to do is to say, okay, well then what is my job, right? If I'm not here to kind of manage all these little ones and help them out, well, remember, if you're using visual supports, you're really using them to scaffold kids' learning. To scaffold them in learning what? Learning self-regulation. And self-regulation means I myself can regulate. Not that you can control me and regulate me by moving a clothespin from a red dot to a yellow dot to a green dot. That's not helping me learn how to regulate. So a couple of my colleagues have a new book out, and Ashley's going to tweet this at hashtag B2KCoach, and you can check it out. Some other colleagues and I have a new Pinterest board that's all about self-regulation and teaching self-regulation, but the book is called Stop, Think, Act, and it's a whole bunch of evidence-based strategies that you can use in the classroom for young children. And what's fabulous about the book is that it doesn't shy away from what we know in terms of brain development, all the new findings around neuroscience, all the stuff that we know about relationships with children, but it also keeps it kind of light in the sense that kids need to move and sing and dance and play in order to learn to self-regulate. So if you kind of like that idea that we are no longer the managers, that's number one, and two, what our job is to teach children to regulate. So over the coming weeks, Ashley and I are going to keep sharing things that are, how do you teach self-regulation? Isn't that kind of like ooey gooey? I don't want to touch that. I don't know what to do with that kind of ooey gooey when a kid's having a meltdown. So we're going to give you some really specific things. But again, you can check out Stop, Think, Act. It's got a fabulous series of activities. And we also have a new app coming out maybe in a month or so that'll also support teaching self-regulation. So first, to turn behavior management upside down, we're no longer the managers. Second, our job is to teach self-regulation. And Ashley and I are working really hard with colleagues all over to give really concrete strategies that you can then coach others. You can tell families about them. You can work on them with your co-teachers. But they're really specific things that have a really strong evidence base that help children. The third thing is back to that original intention of doing the public displays in the first place, and that was to give kids visual support. We know that visual supports are incredibly effective, and not just for kids with autism, right? We all need them. We all need that extra input to let us know when to go, when to stop, when something's right, when something's wrong. And so visual supports are really important. So in our B2K blog this last week, Ashley and I gave several resources and supports. One, we wrote a B2K practice point that you can download and share with your administrators, your colleagues, put it in your school newspaper, if they still have them, your classroom blog. And there are strategies for using visual supports effectively. We also directed you back to CEFL. Many of you know the CEFL's work and how credible those researchers are and how practical their work is in terms of how to make good visual supports. And then lastly, my colleague Barbara Avila just blogged yesterday, or maybe the day before, about how to use visual supports kind of on the fly. So we kind of know about visual supports in terms of board maker, or making a visual schedule, or having labels around the classroom. But how do you use visual supports on the fly? That meaning you're, you know, walking in the hallway, or you're out on the playground, or something unexpected happened and you don't have all of your pre-made things. So those in our third suggestion is to use visual supports effectively. We've given you three strategies: a B2K practice point, some work from CEFL, and then the third thing is a blog from Barbara Avila. So a couple of people are saying that people are having trouble with the buffering. So yeah, and that's nothing that I can control. I can control very little in the world, but I appreciate people's attempts to come back and forth and in and out. And it'll be recorded, so if you missed part of it, you are welcome to catch it on the backside. So our fourth thing, let's see, did I do the four? Oh, I've missed one. Okay, so we were going through four things that we can do to, instead of, I call them replacement behaviors, so four things that we can do that turn behavior management upside down. And the first, we're no longer managers of children's behavior. Second, we're going to teach self-regulation, and we are at hashtag B2K Coach giving you lots of places you can go to learn more about how to teach self-regulation. Third, we want you to use visual supports. We know that that was the original intention of ever using these behavioral charts and cards. So how can we do this effectively? How can we use visual supports in a way that is not public shaming, is helpful, and is giving kids the scaffolding that they need to be successful? The last step, the very final thing that we'll talk about today before your call to action, is we've given you some prevention strategies. And so again, at hashtag B2K Coach, that image will come up. You can catch it in our blog from last Tuesday. But there's 10 things that we can do that sort of prevent meltdowns in the first place. That said, when you work with young children, they're going to have meltdowns. It's sort of developmentally appropriate. So we can't prevent them all, as much as our building administrators might want us to, or maybe even ourselves. We would love it if kids had self-regulatory control all the time. Even after we teach the skills, they may not. They won't. So we want to make sure that we have some prevention strategies that we share with others as well. And so Ashley and I came up with 10 prevention strategies that will reduce your need to do visual supports in the first place. But then again, if you do want to use visual supports, let's do it in a way that doesn't shame kids, doesn't lead to bullying, doesn't lead to confusion. But let's use visual supports in a way that scaffolds and support their learning. All right, so let's end today's broadcast Periscope with just a restatement of the four things, the four replacement behaviors that turn behavior management upside down. And then you have a call to action. So you might want to write this down. You might want to get ready to pause the recording so that you can ready yourself. But again, the four things that were replacement behaviors to turn this idea of managing others upside down was just that. We're not the managers of other people's behaviors. That's number one. Number two, we want to actually teach self-regulation. And we're going to be giving you lots and lots of strategies, from our work on Pinterest to our book recommendations to a forthcoming app that will really support our intentional efforts to teach self-regulation. The third thing is we want to support all of our use of visual supports in a productive and scaffolding way. And then fourth, Ashley and I have given you a series of prevention strategies, things to consider across child cares, across Head Starts, across preschool classrooms, in kindergarten classrooms, in homes. We want to do these prevention things first and foremost. So those are your four things to turn behavior management upside down. All right, so here's your call to action. This is your task for the week, all right? And so this was a tweetable that Ashley and I had in our blog this week. And again, you might want to write it down. You might want to just reflect on it for a minute. But here's your question or your call to action. How can you, well, really each of us, emphasize citizenship over subordination? And how can you emphasize self-regulation over compliance? So if you like this idea that we're really promoting citizenship and self-regulation, not subordination and compliance, you can give some hearts, you can make a comment, you can make a note to yourself. What can I do in whatever my job or my role is to promote citizenship and self-regulation versus subordination and compliance? So there you go. That's another weekly scope here at B2K Solutions. Thanks for joining me. And thanks for those of you who have joined virtually after the fact. And sorry for the buffering this week. I'll stay on in case people jump back on or have a question. Otherwise, have a fabulous week.